Hello, it's Keith here, and this is lesson 36 of the platform-specific series of my 6502 assembly programming tutorials. This week we're going to be looking at hardware sprites on the Commodore 64. Now, the Commodore 64 had good bitmap graphics, but it was the hardware sprites that really pushed it above systems like the Amstrad CPC and really helped it win in the sort of 8-bit wars of the 80s and early 90s. Now, the hardware sprites on the Commodore 64 are quite interesting. They can be either two colour, with one colour being transparent, or four colour, with one transparent colour and three other colours. But they don't have to all be the same configuration, and they don't have to be the same configuration as the screen. So the screen could be four colour screen, and the sprites could be just one colour. And we can also have some three colour sprites and some one colour sprites and combine them together. Now, the sprites use 63 bytes, but when they're aligned, they'll be effectively 64 bytes. They are always 21 lines tall, and in 1-bit per pixel mode, 2-colour mode, they will be 24 pixels wide and 21 pixels tall. In 2-bit per pixel, 4-colour mode, they'll be 12 pixels wide and 21 tall, but they'll actually be twice the width. So the width doubles up rather than the sprites getting narrower. Now, colour 0 is always transparent. Colours 1 and 2 in 4-colour mode use a fixed colour, and each sprite has a single colour that is definable at the sprite level. Now, as I say, we've got 8 sprites, and they have a variety of memory mapped registers here, as you can see. But the actual bitmap data for the sprites will have to be in our normal memory in the same area as the video memory. And this is where things are going to get a little bit tricky for us, unfortunately. Now, there are some quite important rules when it comes to defining the sprites. The sprites have to be within the same 16 kilobyte bank as the rest of our video memory. The sprite pointers that point to the memory that is used by the bitmap data for our sprites is in this range here, and we effectively will write the memory address divided by 64, so that we're just writing a single byte, and it has to be byte aligned to a 64 byte origin. Now, that's not too bad. What is a real problem for us, though, is there is, unfortunately, when it comes to the video processor, the VIC chip, there is an area of memory within the first 16 kilobytes, the quadruple zero to 3FFF range, that is used by the character ROM. Now, we can't see this from the CPU normally, but when the VIC chip comes to write, it will be unable to access the 1000 to 2000 range of RAM and the 9000 to 8000 range. These will always show up as this character ROM, and we can't turn that character ROM off to the video chip. We can turn it on and off to the CPU, but the video chip always sees it in those ranges. Now, if you think about our system memory, the 2000 to 3FFF range is used by our bitmap memory, and the lower ranges are going to be used by our program, the stack, and things like that. So actually, as part of today's example, we're not just going to learn how to use the sprites, we're actually going to remap the screen memory from the 4000 to 8000 range, and that means we can have our screen, and we've got all of the rest of that memory for our standard data color information and also for the hardware sprites. And because that one range doesn't have any problems with the VIC ROM affects the higher range and the lower range, but it doesn't affect that middle range. That's going to give us lots and lots of RAM for sprites. So that's what I'm going to be doing in today's example, and we're going to learn how to do that. So there we go. So the RAM that we're going to be working with by default will be the 07F8 and 07FF range for the sprite pointers, these 1-byte pointers that tell the sprites what memory to use. But if we relocate the screen, these will change as well. So it would be 47F8 to 47FF in the example today, but I'm actually using an offset for that. Now, wherever the screen is, the rest of the hardware registers are in fixed positions. So we've got X and Y coordinates here for each of the 8 sprites. Now, you can see that there's an X and Y byte here. Those are pretty logical. But because of the width of the screen, 8 bits isn't enough to define the X position. So there's actually another bit, and you can see they're all combined for the X position into this 1 byte here, which is a bit of a pain. Equally a pain is that you can see here there's a 1 bit per sprite here defining other options, that simply the turning on of the sprite, the doubling of the height, the doubling of the width, setting the priority, setting the color, and other things. So all of these, if we want to set these, we're going to have to shift our setting depending on the sprite we actually want to set. So that's going to be a pain, but we're going to write some code that's going to work around that. Okay, well, enough talk. Let's actually just see the actual example working today. Okay, so this is what we've got. We've got our Tubico 1-bit per pixel bitmap in the background here, and we've got these two sprites here. These are hardware sprites here. So this is a four-color sprite, and it's been double-sized in the X and Y axis. This is just a two-color sprite, so we've got it in green here, and it's unscaled. So you can see there's two hardware sprites here at different sizes. So these are using different bitmap data, because you need to use different image data for a four-color sprite or a two-color sprite. Now, you can create the correct bitmap data with my Aku Sprite Editor. This isn't the same sprite, but this will do the job. And if we go to 6502 and we go to, where is it? Commodore 64. We've got save two-color sprite and save four-color sprite. And this is what I use to output the data that was used in today's example. Okay. So what do we need to do to get our sprites working? Well, first of all, of course, we need to actually have sprite data. And you can see it just here. We're loading in two sprites here. These need to be 64 bytes in total, even though the sprites are technically 63, because otherwise they won't align properly. But these two will align just perfectly. And then if we go back to the top of our code here, now what we're doing here is we're loading in the source destination of that sprite data. We're loading the size of it. And then we're loading a destination here. We're using this fake LDIR command. LDIR means load and increment. It's a Z80 command, but I've got a fake version here for my 6502 programming. And we've got this definition screen base plus 1000. Now, the screen base in this example is set to 4000, and we're going to look at how we've done that just here. Now, here's our bitmap memory code, and we've got these new checks for these definitions here. Now, I've defined this screen base 4000 statement here, and that means that this code will run. So we're defining a word level screen base and a byte level one, just depending on what we require. And then if the screen base is set to 4000 here, what we're doing is we're clearing the bottom two bits here of DD00 and then setting them to 10. There's also some code for the 8000 range, but the 8000 range isn't so good for sprites because, as I said, it's also affected by this problem of the character data, the character ROM getting in the way. So it's the 4000 range that's easiest and the most flexible. And if you're getting started, I think that's the one you're going to want to use. Now, as well as this extra code here, I've had to reprogram the functions routines so that these now write to the screen base when it comes to doing characters, clearing the screen, and also the bitmap data functions now are having to take into account that screen base here. So there's been a lot of changes here to take into account the fact that the screen won't definitely be a hexadecimal 2000 for the bitmap data and things like that. But this has given us some much more flexible code that we can use if we need our code reconfiguring for big sprites or big program code. So I think in the long run, this is definitely a plus. So at this point, we've now loaded our sprite data into memory address, into offset 1000 from our screen base. Now, we're going to think of this as an offset because it's important when it comes to the next part. We're going to define an X position here. We're loading to position 200 on the X axis and 150 on the Y axis. Now, at this point, we are loading in the offset here. The offset was 1000. We're dividing it by 64 and we're storing that pointer into ZH here. Now, the video chip itself will only see that 16K range, so it doesn't want the full address. It only wants the offset, and it wouldn't store in a single byte anyway if it was the full address. So this 1000 here is the same as this 1000 here. So that's how we are specifying the data for the first sprite here. We're then specifying the color here. We're specifying whether we want it to be in four color mode and whether we're scaling the X and Y positions. We're storing that extra information in ZL, and we're specifying the number of the hardware sprite. We're using sprite 0 for this first test. We're then doing a second test down here. It's the second sprite data, so we're having to add 64 here, hexadecimal 40, because that's how much each sprite is. So to calculate the address of the second sprite within our offset sprite data, we have to add 64 hexadecimal 40. We store that in ZH. This time we're using a different color, and we're not scaling, and we're not using four color mode. And we're storing that into ZL again. This time we're using sprite 1 here, we used sprite 0 before. Now if we use sprite 0 here and here, then the second time we ran this command, it would effectively remove the first sprite, because you've got to remember these are hardware sprites. This isn't just drawing a sprite to the screen, it's setting the screen hardware to draw the sprite for us. So every time you want to use a different number up to 7, and if you go over that, you're going to have to somehow cope with that, either with some trick of, say, recalculating the sprites while the screen draws, or flickering the sprites alternate frames, or moving one of them to a software sprite, something like that. So this is the code we're using as a test, and it's what you just saw. But of course, all the work of actually interfacing the hardware is in this setHardware sprite function, and that's what we're going to have a look at now. Now, when this function executes, we're going to have the accumulator set to the hardware sprite number that we need to work with. Now, a lot of our functions are working by hardware sprite number, but unfortunately, all of the data for all of the sprites is in a single byte, so we're going to need to work on bit position a lot. Now, as part of my tutorial code in the basic functions routine, we've got these lookups. We can look up a bit set to 1, set by bit position, or we can have a mask setting it to 0 by bit position, and we're going to need these in this case. So when it comes to actually setting one of the sprites and turning it on, we're going to need to load in the current status of the sprites, and then we're going to need to all one of the sprites on, set depending on the sprite number. So we moved the sprite number, the hardware sprite number, to Y here. We're then ORing in that bit, so if you look at those bits, if Y is 0, we'll be ORing that 1 to 1. If it's 1, we'll be ORing that 1 to 1, and so on. And that's exactly what we need for these values in this register here. So that lookup table is really going to help us out when it comes to doing things, and it's going to help us out here just turning the sprite on. Okay, so we've turned the sprite on. We've got to now do a variety of other tasks to the other attributes. And all of these attributes, the double height, the double width, these are all done in the same way. Now, if you look at the command we passed along, we were merging all of these options into a single byte in ZL. And so what we're going to do is we're going to pick out one of these attributes here, for example, bit 4 here, which is the 4 color option. And then we're going to move it into the correct position for the sprite, because of course the 4 color option is this one here, and we're going to need to move it into the correct position, and then we're going to need to OR it in, as well as stripping out any existing value from the previous setting here. And we're going to use this function here, convert to mask. Now, what we do is we specify in the accumulator the bit that we want to keep. For example, for the 4 color option, it's this bit here. That's because we want to keep this bit here. And so we load that into the accumulator, run this function. This function then ANDs the ZL, because the ZL is our various attributes here. And then if that's 0, it will jump down to here. And because that will mean the accumulator is already 0, that will be stored in here. We'll then load in the equivalent mask for the same option. And if it wasn't 0, we will load in a 1 value in the equivalent position. So, I mean, I know that's a little bit confusing, but effectively, once this function's run, the accumulator will be a mask to clear out the bit, and then ZAS will either be a 1 or a 0, depending on the bit that was specified in the accumulator when we executed. So basically, we can use this to set D01C here to 1 or 0, depending on this bit in ZL. So we do that with the 4 color option here. We then do it with the double height option here. Then we do it with the double width option here. And this is setting each of these by just one of those bits each time in ZL. Next, we're going to set the pointer. This is going to be at 7F8, offset to the screen base. Now, as I said before, the defaults are here, but if we are setting our screen base to hexadecimal 4000, which we are, then it will be 47F8 to 47FF. But we're just calculating as screen base plus, because screen base is being defined in our header just here according to the system. So that's an easy way of allowing our code to work on any screen base we're specifying. Then we're using ZL again, but this time we want all the bottom nibble, so we're just filtering it here, and we're storing it to D027 offset by Y, Y of course being the hardware sprite number. And that's because in this rare case we've actually got a full byte per sprite here. So by offsetting by Y, we're moving down depending on what the specified sprite is. Now, the last thing we need to do is we need to get the top bit of the IX. Now, the last thing we need to do is get the top bit of the X position, which was in the bottom bit of IXH. Now, we're using that convert to mask function, but we don't want to use L this time, so we're jumping to a slightly different position, and we're just stripping that bottom bit of IXH here and then jumping into here. But the effect when we return is the same. The bit will be 1 or 0 depending on what the 8 bit of X need to be. So we're just ORing that in to D010, which as you can see here is the last bit of the coordinate for the sprites, and as again, they're all combined into that one single byte there. Okay, we've got two final things to do then. Set the X and Y position. Now, the X and Y position are two full bytes, and they're next to each other by sprites. So sprite 0 is at D000 and D001, sprite 1's at D002 and D003. So effectively what we want to do is double the hardware sprite number that was specified to us all the way up here, and then use that as an offset. So we transfer Y back to A, shift it to the left, doubling it, and move it back to Y. Now we've got an offset that we can use for our two values. So we just load in the low byte of IXL and then load in the low byte of IYL, and we store them to D000 offset by Y and D001 offset by Y, and that will set the X and Y position. Now you will notice that we only use IYL here, we never used IYH, so me setting it in this source code was superfluous, but never mind. Anyway, a bit of a pain there, but that's a way we can write a function that will set the hardware sprites and most of the options here. Yeah, we haven't actually set the collision options, but again, it gives us enough to get started, and this allows us to show some hardware sprites onto the screen. So there we go. That's given us some basic sprite functionality. As I say, you can download my AcuSprite editor to make some sprites of your own. It's free and open source, so hopefully that'll be some use to you. Yeah, once you've got this working, maybe you want to try something a bit more adventurous. You could try playing with the collision options, or you could try and write your own tables that will actually swap the sprites around as the screen's redrawing. But that's going to be outside of what I'm looking to do in these tutorials at this stage. Anyway, I hope you've enjoyed this. Thanks for watching, and goodbye. If you enjoyed today's lesson, please check out my website. We've got tutorials, source code and development tools for 6502, 68000 and Z80 systems, and a lot more systems coming in the future. We're going to be covering the 8086 and the ARM and a few other things as well going forward. And if you've liked this lesson, if you've got questions, comments or suggestions on how it could be made better, please consider signing up to my forum. It's free, of course, and you can come along here and you can make suggestions, you can ask questions. And if you've got assembly projects you're working on, please let us know what they are. Maybe show off a few screenshots, tell us what things you've found interesting or what tricks you've come up with, because we'd love to know about it. Anyway, thanks for watching today and goodbye.